Thank you. It's an honor to be here with you all and talk a little bit about the book that I wrote. There was a time in my life, actually, when I was going to apply to the University of Toronto to study philosophy, but there was a mail strike. And so I couldn't come here at that point because you couldn't get the mail through. So it's a twist of fate, and I ended up at the University of Texas, quite a different part of the world. But I've always had great respect for this university and great respect for Canada, of course, and I'm very happy to have been invited to come and talk today about this trial involving Fethullah Gülen in Turkey. And it was it's a political trial and a political prosecution, and while it was very painful, I'm sure, for Mr. Gülen and for members and believers in the movement, there was a good ending. And that's very unusual for political trials. Typically, it's a bad ending, and typically people end up in jail or killed, right? We can go back to Socrates, we have Jesus, the Inquisition, the Salem witch trials in my country, and so on. But this is a trial that actually has great impact on democracy in Turkey. And is a result, in a sense, too, of the growing move toward democracy in Turkey. And I want to make a disclaimer at the beginning because I'm going to make criticism of parts of the system in Turkey. And I want to make sure that I put on the table that I'm not an American exceptionalist. I do not believe the United States has a unique claim on civil liberty or human rights or anything like that. I've been doing this for 40 years. So I have sued my own government plenty of times, and I hope to live many more years and have many more lawsuits. As we say, knock on wood in Texas. So anyhow, just keep that in mind when I'm making criticisms, that it has nothing to do. It's my perspective as a human rights lawyer and has nothing to do with the country that I'm coming from. So there are five questions probably that we can use to focus my comments around, right? The first question would be, why prosecute Fethullah Gülen? This is a person that Monsignor Maravich, who was the representative of the Pope in Istanbul, called a saint. Why prosecute him? Why prosecute the movement? The second question would be, what was the charge? The third, who is the opposition here that propels this? Fourth, who are the actors that came into play to accomplish this agenda? And fifth, what was the wild card? There is a very unique wild card that does change the outcome, I think, in the direction of the trial and everything in Turkey. Let's start with the first point. Why prosecute Fethullah Gülen and the movement? The movement, what we call the movement, or what is called the movement in the current discussions about the Gülen movement, is, you know, it comes out of represents the moderate Sufi tradition in Turkey. Very moderate, very much committed to the idea that science and religion work together, interact with each other, strengthen each other. And it's also very ecumenical in the sense that it makes no effort at conversion, that the only way you're going to get to heaven is become a Muslim, but is that there's dialogue, that there's value in the dialogue, and that people talking to each other, or as Rumi would say, souls seeing each other, is a very important way that we develop our own personal spirituality, which means we also develop a very important role in developing society, and this is called civil society. The movement identifies itself not as a religious movement, but as a civil society movement. even though the people in it are religious and have religious belief, and that has nothing to do with the development, from our perspective, as civil society. So it's a movement, and it's a movement that began, in a sense, by emphasizing what's called Hizmet, service to the community. And one of the first manifestations of this service to the community was education, building schools. There are currently, around the world, 1,000 schools, at least, that are associated in some sense with the movement in 130 countries. My own state of Texas, where I'm from, there are 26 schools called Harmony Schools. And 20,000 students are attending those schools, and 30,000 students are on the waiting list. So it gives you an idea of the reputation that the schools have. When the schools began, Gulen is very famous for saying, what we need is not more mosques, but more schools. There's a great emphasis on education. And when the schools began in Turkey, one of the places that the movement set up schools was in the Kurdish area. And the idea was, you know, that because the state, the government, the national government was not good at putting schools in the Kurdish area, to put more schools to give kids the opportunity to go to school instead of going up into the mountains and becoming PKK terrorists, and give them an alternative that they could build a life. It's also important that the schools were also very important for women, because this provided an opportunity for women to go to school and not have to get married at 14 and 15, but have a career or a vocation or develop a professional life if they wanted to. So it was an alternative to the way life was in the Kurdish area. I don't know, there was an article, I don't know if you saw it, an article a year or two ago in Pakistan that the only schools there that were alternative to madrasa, which are the mosque schools, were the Gulen schools. The Gulen schools are totally, they're non-religious. You don't learn anything about religion. You don't practice religion. The idea is that the teachers, by their good example, will inspire students. And I've been to, since I've been involved in this in the last 4 years, I've been to many, many Gulen schools, and I have seen that to be the case. In fact, I actually have a slide of one of them here. I tell you, the reason I have this slide, because this was really inspiring to me. I went and talked to these kids. They were in a very poor area of Antalya in Turkey. And I asked these kids, I think they're fourth or fifth graders, if I remember correctly. I said, what do you want to be when you grow up? And the kids said, well, I want to be a doctor, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a police officer. You know, and I was thinking, this is pretty good for kids this age. They would never have had this dream had it not been for the schools. Just having that dream. Now I have two kids that are teachers in very poor areas. One in San Antonio, they're both in the San Antonio area, very poor schools. And when they asked their students, what do you want to be? One said, well, I want to be a crossing guard. You know what a crossing guard is? You know, so the kids cross the street to go to school. You know, that's kind of sad, in a sense, you know. And so this was very inspiring to me to see that these kids have dreams they would never have had but for the schools that the movement has set up, or this one here in Italia. Another part of this Hizmet movement is also the charitable foundation component, Kimse Yokmu, which is raises money for catastrophes around the world. There was a lot of money raised for the tsunami, for example, in Southeast Asia, earthquakes in South America. When the earthquake struck the Van area in Turkey last year, the foundation did an overnight telethon, raised $37 million to help support the people that were struck by that event. Another part of the movement also that's developing pretty rapidly is media. Provide a newspaper, Saman, in Turkey that has the largest circulation. It's also published in English, published in a variety of languages. And when my first trip to Turkey, I knew nothing about the movement whatsoever. I knew very little about Islam. And the only thing I studied in Turkey, of course, was in Catholic school, so it wasn't a very accurate version of Turkey, if you can imagine. So I was looking around a hotel for something to read, the English papers. There were three or four different kinds, but the one I ended up reading most often was Saman, not realizing it was associated with the movement, because I thought it was actually the best version I could find about international events going on and so on in English. It turns out it was Saman. But there are also, the movement's also involved in creating television stations, family programming, good news programs. One of the criticisms I'll have a little bit later about Turkey during this time of the trial was how bad the media was. It would be like Fox News. I don't know if you get Fox News up here, but in the United States it is pathetic, right? It would be what Orwell called newspeak, right? It's just awful. But that, we'll get to that in a minute. But the most, I think, the most important part and the most non-tangible, intangible part of the movement is the dialogue that the movement promotes. And that is talking to each other, going on trips to Turkey, meeting people, having these kinds of dialogues. I went on a trip to Turkey, and there have been thousands of people now that have gone to Turkey on these trips. And it depends what kind of group you're in. My first group was an interfaith group, so we had Christians and Jews. And you meet, so you go to the schools, you meet various peoples. But the most interesting part, of course, is eating in people's houses at night. Go to people's houses and have dinner with them. That is really amazing dialogue. And you ask questions. Why are you wearing the hijab and your sister's not? Or that kind of thing. Or why, what is the movement about to you? What are you doing? Why do you belong to it? That kind of stuff. You can have these discussions. Or questions like, how many kids do you have? You know, that regular stuff that you would do at a meal. That's really part of the dialogue. Again, as I said, Sufis say, souls seeing each other, right? It's a very important part of the movement is the dialogue, and it's also the most nebulous part, but it's also probably the most important part, ultimately, especially for us in the West, because many of us have a very perverted view of what happens on the other side of the ocean, and very undiscerning view of Islam. There are two other parts of the movement that actually give rise to criticism, and I want to mention them. One is what's called a non-transparency, and that's sort of related to the second part, is the question of structure, right? For me, as a lawyer, I'm always looking for structure. Where's the CEO? Where's the CFO? Where's the hierarchy? How are everybody connected? Well, the movement's very non-structured. It's people coordinate with each other, but it's not structured. There are two reasons for that. One is the Sufi thing. Sufi beliefs are not, the Sufi tradition is very non-hierarchical, more democratic, more consensus building, like Quakers, for example. And the other thing is, I'll get to when we get to the trial, is that it's also self-defense in the legal system, not to have structure, so that the state, when it goes after you, can't seize the property. It's a very real issue. But that becomes a, you know, we talk about that, that always becomes, the press sometimes has an issue with this, and says, well, there's non-transparency. It's just something to keep in mind. Maybe we could talk about it during some questions if you have that. But from what I can tell, and I've now been talking about the book for about 2 months now in different parts of the U.S. and different parts of Europe, and I really don't think, from what I can see, that there is a lot of structure. There is a lot of coordination, but I don't think, from what I can see, I think that that's probably the case. Okay. One last footnote, and that is the movement is non-political. This is another problem the press has, I think, sometimes. It is involved in politics, but it is not involved in politics as a political party. It does not support blindly a political party. The AK party is in power right now in Turkey, as you know. And many times the movement, people in the movement will support what the party's doing, and just as many times recent years it will oppose what the party's doing. So Gulen himself is very clear there has to be separation of religion and state. But participating in politics is very important. Participating in politics is very important, but you don't want to become a political party because you know what happens then. I mean, you know, all the corruption and the power, and you get more interested in building your power base than you are in building society. So that's something to keep in mind. So you will have seen, for example, in the constitutional amendments that were passed in 2010, on the 30th anniversary to the date of the 1980 coup, that the movement was very strong pushing those constitutional amendments. It was essentially a Bill of Rights. And the movement has been just as critical now against the current Prime Minister Erdogan for not pushing the new constitution. There needs to be a new constitution to change some of the structures. And he's slacking off. And so the movement's really been on his case to try to have that happen. Second point. Second question. What was the charge against Fethullah Gülen that he eventually came to trial on? And that was that he was a terrorist. And the 3713, infamous Article 3713, labeled anybody who wanted to change the essential nature of the state as a terrorist. That was it. So, if you said, I want to, let's talk about changing parliament so that we have two houses instead of one, and that they serve for fixed terms instead of at the pleasure of the election, that would be changing the essential nature of the state, and you would be a terrorist under 3713. Or if you said, let's do away with the president, we don't need to have a president, why don't we just have to let the prime minister do all the business? That would be changing the essential nature of the state. Gulen is not the only one who's prosecuted under 3713. There's a whole slew of people that are consistently and constantly prosecuted for their political views under and prosecuted under the statute as a terrorist. I'm going to go through a number of the individual charges specifically that were filed against him, but I think that there are two subtext sort of overarching ideas that play through this. One is the question of, is the idea to change the secular nature of the state towards Sharia law or theocracy? And the other is Gulen making himself to be the religious leader of the Islamic community? I think these were the two fears, and I'm going to come back and explain why that how that plays out. But I think if you look at the subtext to all the charges, that's what they're worried about. Now, how that changes the essential nature of the state, of course, is that if you become the Islamic leader, you will have displaced the minister of religion. Turkey controls religion, right? It pays the imams, it writes their Sunday sermon, it writes their Friday sermons and pays for the mosque. So it's very direct control over religious practice. And so if you change that, that would be changing the essential nature of the state, right? Because it's no longer the state-appointed minister that would be the leader. I think that's part of the subtext. The other part is a definitional question that I think comes up a lot and is quite often misunderstood in the West. And it's very misunderstood in the press. When I say the press, I'm talking about the New York Times, for example. I see that a lot. Or I was just in Germany talking, and I think the issue was the same issue came up in Der Spiegel. Because sometimes we hear, oh, they want to change the secular nature, or they want to change, an effort to change secularism in Turkey. And we think that that's a bad thing because we have a different definition of the word. For me in the United States, and I suspect this is true of Canada from what I know about your legal system, is that secular means that the government is not going to support or promote a particular religion. On the other hand, the government will accommodate, will not discriminate against you on a basis of religion. That's what we generally mean by a secular in the West or in the United States. In Turkey, it means something different. Turkey, it means the government controls religion, as I told you, through the Ministry of Religion. But it also means you will not have any religious practice manifest in public employment, in the public sector, or in the public universities. So when I got on the plane to leave Houston to go to Germany, one of the people, you know, when you have to go through all that, you know, that fancy security apparatus these days, one of the women there who was the guard or whatever you call them, the police woman or security woman, had a hijab on. Because under our law, and I imagine this is pretty typical, is that that's an accommodation. As long as that does not interfere with her doing her job, she can express her religion. In Turkey, you cannot do that. I could not land at the airport in Istanbul and expect to see anybody in the public sector, any woman in the public sector, expressing religion. And of course, there are all sorts of other things that go on. You know, if you wear, you know, there are other ways that the government also imposes restrictions on religion. That is very important, I think, to understand the definitional difference when we're watching stuff that happens in the press, in the commentaries about what's going on in Turkey. Three, who was the opposition? Why prosecute Fethullah Gülen? If you're familiar with the history of Turkey, and I imagine a lot of you are, it's complicated. First of all, I think what was happening is that as people in Anatolia got more educated through the Gulen movement, that education was a premier goal, that what you see happening was a change, a push of change in economic life. You see a rising middle class in Anatolia. The rising middle class, of course, says we want more of the economic pie. And historically, the economic pie had been concentrated in Istanbul. You know, the whole white Turks versus black Turks thing. Istanbul versus Anatolia. And so all of a sudden, the pie is only so big, right? And if you say, give me some of your pie, people don't like to give up their pie. That's part of the issue. It was a change in economic life. That's not the only part of it, though. The military in Turkey has a sordid history of intervening whenever they understand that the country is going in the wrong direction. And so there have been very bloody coups in 1960, 1971, 1980. The 1960 coup, they even hanged the prime minister and two of the ministers of the cabinet. You know, pretty amazing, 1960 that happened. And then there was a soft coup, as they call it, a coup by email to the government on February 28, 1997, either you resign or we'll bring the tanks. And that's a famous, and I'll come back to that in a minute, that's a famous line of demarcation in some of these events, is the February 28th coup. Now, the military was also involved. Military had a very, if you've been to Turkey and if you've seen the gated communities that the military live in, it's a nice life of privilege. Gated communities, nice houses, their own shopping centers, their own schools, their own buses. Very nice life of privilege, and after you serve a period of time, then you can retire on a nice pension. For every soldier, ground level, in Turkey, there are three officers. So it gives you an idea of the life of privilege that's going on in Turkey. Thank you. I'm losing my notes here. So the other thing is that at this time, the military would simply say to Parliament, we need 40% of the budget this year, or we need 45% of the national budget. And they got a blank check. There was no accountability. Just give us the money. And that's what happened. So you saw the military had sort of this sub-economy where it invested and had its own businesses, had tie-ins, for example, with Mercedes-Benz. But also, even more than that, what happened is that the generals would move over to the banks and sit on the board of directors as they retired, or move over and sit on the board of directors of corporations, or move over and sit on the board of directors of the media. So you had this unhealthy interrelationship that went on, incestuous relationship. Now, President Eisenhower, when he was leaving office after 8 years in the United States, gave a very famous speech. He said, the greatest danger to democracy is the military-industrial complex. He was probably right, and of course, as you know from history, we never listened to him, right? I mean, we have Vietnam, Afghanistan, Iraq, and so on. But it's a very unhealthy relationship because the military-industrial complex will drive war. Anyhow, what happened during this period of these interlocking relationships is the state treasury was bled of $25 billion. Just disappeared because the military, they would give loans to each other. $25 billion disappeared. In today's value, that would be $1 trillion. Disappeared. So the World Bank intervenes and says, hey, this is no way to run a government. You can't be bleeding the treasury without accountability. There's no transparency. There are no records. Where did the money go? If you want us to support you any longer, you have to change the law. There's a media campaign coming up against Gulen that I'm going to talk about as a prelude to the trial. But the day that this goes into Parliament to change the law because of corruption is the day the media campaign begins. So it's a very opportune distraction about the fact that the Treasury had been looted of so much money by this interlocking directorate. The other things that have gone on, I think, of where the opposition comes from, I've touched on, is the question of secularism, the worry about the popular movement, that this is on the ground, rising in Anatolia. It doesn't appear to have structure. People are worried about it. And all of this, in a sense, was what was called deep state in Turkey. Deep state is all of this happening behind the scenes, strange interests in bed with each other. The military, PKK, may have a relationship in which when I saw this happen, actually, in which the PKK would blow up a munitions dump, and that would give the military an excuse to intervene. You know, all sorts of weird stuff that went on behind the scene, called deep state. For a time, it was a theory. But now there have been two trials in Turkey, one called Ergenekon, which is still going on, and one called Sledgehammer, which has just ended and has put 330 military people in prison, and three top generals in prison for 20 years. Very amazing development in Turkey that you have actually civilian courts sending the military to jail. But we now know that it's true about deep state. Part of the Sledgehammer plot was to blow up two of the biggest mosques in Istanbul on Friday, shoot down a Greek fighter over the Aegean, and of course that would cause tremendous turmoil in society and give the military the opportunity to intervene and do a coup. That's been proven. In fact, one of the top military guys testified against the rest of the generals about, you know, that what was in writing. They found a bunch of stuff in writing, and they said, it was just a hypothetical. But then one of the chief of staffs testified, so it was actually a little bit more than a hypothetical. Anyway, that's where opposition. Now, opposition against Gulen, of course, as I said, also extended against other folks that didn't agree with the party line. But he was the one who went to trial, stood up, and forced the issue. Who are the actors? Question four. Who are the actors? I would say there are two principal institutional actors here that come into play. One is the media. I talked about the interrelationship and how bad the media was at that time. In fact, the media has just apologized publicly last week for its complicity with a February 28, 1997 soft coup. It was an apology. It wasn't really, you know, it could have been much better, but at least it was an acknowledgement that they played along with the military. the military would plant stories in the press. The press would pick it up and play it. And the way the press works in Turkey, if you've ever been there, you'll have an article. It'll be leaked, perhaps, or it'll appear Monday morning. It'll appear in the paper in the morning. Then the TV stations will say, guess what was in the paper this morning, and we'll play it. And then the next morning, it's back in the newspaper again. You sort of have this ongoing rolling effect of the news. So the press participated in this very vicious campaign against Fethullah Gülen that began after the soft coup in 1997. Starts in 98. There's an event that happens a little bit before that I want to mention because it's very important. There was also a campaign against Gülen in 1995. And in Turkey at this time, the prosecutor could open a criminal case against you based upon something that was in the press. It's pretty significant, right? Somebody, there's an article in the press about you, and they can open a criminal prosecution. And think about it, if it's something planted, you know, that you're going to get framed really quick. So the prosecutor calls in Gülen, who goes in without a lawyer, interviews the prosecutor about these charges, and closes the case and says there's nothing there. The prosecutor is Yüksel. This is the same prosecutor who in 2000 will turn around and indict Gülen and cite many, many of the incidents for which he had closed the case in 95. Important to keep that in mind, because somebody's pushing Yüksel in 2000 to file the charges again. Anyway, to the 98 campaign, the vicious media campaign. The media campaign begins, and there are all kinds of charges that are getting leaked to the press. That Gülen is a member of the CIA, that he's an agent of Iran, that he's an agent of the Moonies, that he's an agent of China, that he's an agent of whatever you want to name it, that he's setting up terrorist camps in the PKK area, in the Kurdish area, that he's infiltrating the government like an octopus, that they're going to take over the state and the national police. And my favorite, since I'm a Catholic, is that he was a secret cardinal of the Pope. Now, if you're a Catholic, you know the chance of being a secret Muslim cardinal, the Pope, are not very good, especially with this Pope. But you can see what they're doing. Even though they may say contradictory and absurd, what they're doing is appealing to different audiences to stir up opposition to him and to the movement. So the people who worry about the CIA, and of course the U.S. does have a very sordid history with the CIA, would listen to that. Or people who didn't like Christians, or thought that Gülen not an authentic Muslim, would listen to that. Or people who thought that he wanted to set up a theocracy would listen to that. Or people thought that there was a subversive effort to overthrow the government would listen to that. So it didn't matter that they were exclusive of each other, not complimentary, but it played to the audience and stirred up this public question. And the campaign isn't directed just to get ready for the trial, of course. It's to demoralize the movement. Because even if you're in the movement, all of a sudden you're hearing all this stuff in the press, you know, you think, well, where there's smoke, maybe there's fire, right? You get worried about it. In fact, I gave this talk to the University of Wisconsin, and this has actually happened a number of times since then, but I'll just use this as illustrative. That one of the kids comes up afterwards and he says, you know, I remember the campaign. I was a little kid, but my dad was a member of the movement. And when he heard all this stuff in the media, he didn't know what to think. He didn't know what to think. And so, but after a few months, he said, well, we'll see how it works out. And if that had that kind of effect on the movement of demoralizing, it would have even a greater effect on people who weren't part of the movement, but may have supported it or thought it was doing some good stuff. Right? So it's important, I think, to keep in mind that the agenda is not just to get rid of Gülen, which is on the table, but also to demoralize and undermine the movement. Actor two, or institutional actor two, that was the media, is two. The Well, let me finish one point about media. Let me just finish one point. This is also a very fortuitous thing that happened. The campaign begins, and Gulen is in Izmir, and he has a friend who's a lawyer named Fatayun, and Fatayun says to Gulen, look, sue these people for defamation. And Gulen says, no, no, that's not my style, I don't want to do it. No, and the lawyer says, no, do it, do it, do it. Look, we can start winning these cases. Gulen says, no, no, no. Well, eventually Gulen acquiesced. By the time the trial has come, this is going to be a very important point, Gulen has won something like 185 defamation cases against the media. The problem is that the law of defamation in Turkey has no teeth. In the United States, if you defame somebody, say, you know, you're a murderer, or you're a bank robber, or you're an embezzler, the jury will decide how much money you get, how bad the defamation was, with the idea that you not do it again. In Turkey, the law is not that good. Turkey says, well, you have to retract it, maybe. The judge tells you to retract it, publish a correction, or pay the lawyer, whatever it costs the lawyer. And then you get whatever you lost in wages. Well, since Gulen isn't very aesthetical person and didn't have, you know, basically didn't have a high-paying job or anything, there was nothing, the financial incentive to the press was to keep on publishing the same thing. They could pay the little fine, they could do what was called the tech zip, but they made more money by replaying the same record. And if you look at, on the website, I have all these cases. I have all of the legal documents on the website, English and Turkish. But you can look and you'll see the same thing is going on. Cemuriyet, for example, in the newspapers, was a prime offender, constantly doing the same thing, constantly being found liable, and then constantly being going back and doing exactly the same article again. So, you know, that it's a paper tiger, the law of defamation, but it comes back in the trial in a very important way, which we'll get to in a minute. The second institutional actor is the court system in Turkey. When the military wrote the constitution in 1982, under which the country currently operates, they created it was a very clever, very ingenious constitution. They created a judiciary that was totally independent of any democratic input. You had what was called the Supreme Council of Judges and Prosecutors. Under the Supreme Council of Judges and Prosecutors, they appoint all the judges, all of the prosecutors, including the High Constitutional Court. And then when they retire, they appoint somebody among themselves. So you have this self-perpetuating institution that is Kemalist, Kemalist being the philosophy of the original republic, and it intervenes all the time. The Constitutional Court is constantly kicking elected political parties out of parliament. It has that kind of power. It can kick you out of parliament. So that, and I actually interviewed a couple of judges and a couple of prosecutors. I interviewed a military judge who was prosecuting somebody, a military officer, for torture in the Kurdish area. And he was stripped of the case and actually forced to retire by the Supreme Council. I talked to a prosecutor that was doing the same thing on the civil side, and he was transferred all the way across the country to Istanbul, demoted, and basically put in charge of what I would call traffic tickets. So the message is very clear. You do what we want, or we will punish you. And remember, why was it Yüksel came back and did this the second time after he cleared Gulen the first time? The wild card, point five. The European Union, the wild card. As I will show you very quickly, and actually the discussion of the trial won't take as long as all of this, but the European Union, as Turkey is moving into the European Union says, hey, if you want to join us, you need to change your legal system, you need to change your constitutional system, you got to have a Bill of Rights, you've got to change, you got to stop doing political prosecutions, you got to guarantee free speech, you got to guarantee free religion. So we'll watch and see how this plays out. This is the wild card. This is what saves the day, I think, ultimately. Okay, so the trial. It's important to point out that there was a Gulen, this is actually the second trial, the one I wrote the book on. There was a trial in 1971 after the 71 coup. And in that, it was the same thing, terrorist. Pardon? No, I said 71 prosecution after the 70 coup. Is that right? Huh? No, I'm talking about the first prosecution. I'm talking about the first trial of Gulen, not the coup.
Not the coup.
No, I'm talking about the first trial of Gulen, 1971. That was in the military courts. In the military courts. And that means three judges are officers. I'm sorry, three officers are judges. So they convicted Gulen, sent him to 2 years hard punishment, which in Turkey basically means solitary confinement. He had no lawyer. He appealed. On appeal, the military court of appeals set it aside, said it was too rough, too harsh. But by the time it comes back down, Parliament, as it always does after a coup, and after everybody's been arrested for a while, grants amnesty, and the case disappears. What's significant about the 71 coup is the same thing that comes up in the 2000, in the 71 charge indictment is the same thing that comes up in the 2000 indictment. And that is, it's not only Gulen that's indicted, but also all organizations related to him. And under Turkish law, even if you are acquitted, found not guilty, the government can still seize your property if you've been charged. Now, we have the same law in the United States. If I'm driving along my, if I'm driving my car and my son has had some marijuana and left it in the trunk, and the cops stop and search and find that, even though I'm not guilty, I will lose my car. That's the same concept that's at play here. This is another reason why there's no, why you don't have this lack of organizational structure, because the government in the past has repeatedly gone after foundations and property with which the government did not agree for political reasons. So it's a self-defense legally, apart from the whole Sufi philosophical idea. Okay, so anyway, I just point that out, that there's that continuity or that idea of seizing the property, of really going after the movement in 71 and then in the 2000 indictment. During the media campaign in 98, that began in 98, in 99, Fethullah Gülen goes to the United States to the Mayo Clinic and goes there and stays there. Gets treated, but then stays in the United States and gets a religious scholar visa. And I'm going to come back to that because we actually have part of this at the end where the United States tries to revoke the visa later on. The 80-page indictment, followed by Yüksel, goes through all the charges I mentioned and many more. There's some tapes that are played that are spliced together from some of the sermons in which people say what he's trying to do is subvert the government and all of that. But the Yüksel wants 10 years solitary confinement and to seize all of the assets. The trial starts in 2000. It is in the state security court at this point. This is part of the European Union. State Security Court has changed from the military court, from three military as judges to only one military as judge and two non-military. So you have separate state security courts for charges of terrorism. And also part of this is that the military drives the non-military judges home at night, picks them up in the morning for work. So you can imagine the communication that's going on at that point. But the that's the way the court looked. This is in 2000. what happened. And then after that, this goes on for a couple years, and then the Parliament passes a law of amnesty and says, if you do not commit any crimes during the period of time for which we could have sent you to jail, we will dismiss the charge. So in other words, if Gulen did not commit any crime in 10 years, then they would dismiss the charge against him. And Gulen says, no, I want to have the trial, I want to be vindicated, this is hurting the movement, this is awful, what's going on, I want to have the trial. The prosecutor says, we object, we want to have the trial, we want to put Gulen in jail. And the judges say, tough luck, we're going to suspend the trial. And then the trial goes into hiatus. But then there's some more things that happen. European Union. A number of things happen with the European Union. First of all, the European Union says you have to abolish state security courts. All right, so Turkey does that. AKA has come to power, does that. So then Gulen is transferred over to the civil side, in which you have three civil judges. The other thing that happens then, these changes are happening around 2004, the trial's been suspended for 2 years, is that the definition of terrorism is changed. Again, because the European Union says you've got to change it. You can't have these political prosecutions. And so it's not, the definition now includes an act of violence. If you want to change the nature, if you are trying to change the essential nature of the state by violence, that will be terrorism. Violence is a component. Under Turkish law, if you are under indictment and the crime changes in a way that's beneficial to you, you go to trial under the new crime. So Gulen was entitled to go to trial under the new definition of terrorism, that there was an act of violence. And because in the indictment, there is no claim at all of violence. In fact, there's never been an allegation of violence against Gulen. So he had a couple good lawyers in Turkey who filed a 146-page brief going through all of the evidence, discounting everything that I mentioned, all of the charges, saying we wanted the judges to reopen the case under the new crime and acquit, find Gulen not guilty. And the judges then, somewhere during this process, call up the national police. They run a crime check. Everything comes back. No act of violence by Gulen. No act of violence by anybody associated with him. No act of violence at all. 2006, May the 5th, the judges acquit Gulen. And I have it again up on the website. Every one of the charges you have ever heard about Gulen, and is still out there on the website, you know, all this web stuff going on, the judges go through and discount, evaluate all of the evidence, step by step by step. 2006. The prosecutor says, we're going for the appeal. So they file the appeal. The appeal goes up. Takes 2 years, and there are five judges that hear the appeal, on the way it works on appeal. They come back 2 years later in 2008, not guilty. We agree. Then it goes up to the full Supreme Court of Appeals, 23 judges. And those judges come back 17-6, say not guilty. Now, one of the things that's happened in here that's been really important in the trial opinion is that when the judges write that, they go back and they look at these cases of defamation. And they say, we aren't the only judges that have made these decisions about these false charges presented against Gulen. Look at what all the other judges have done around the country. They all have come to the same conclusion that we have. We also did all of this checking on violence. There's nothing there. So in 2008, in the summer of 2008, in June the 24th, Gulen is acquitted of all the charges. It's also a good month for him because he was also named one of the top intellectuals in the world by a poll that was conducted by Prospect magazine in Britain and U.S. foreign policy, liberal and conservative magazines. 500,000 people voted. Gulen, I believe, was named number one, certainly one of the top ones. But there's going to be a trifecta here. In 2006, when the trial has heated up in Turkey, the United States government moves to revoke his religious scholar visa. He's another good lawyer in the United States. That lawyer manages to get the case into federal court, which is very difficult to do in our system. The federal courts generally cannot review immigration decisions. Anyway, they get into federal court, they get a judge, and the judge, we have some hearings that go on. At one point, the judge says, how do you think this, he's not a religious scholar? I mean, here's a fellow who has written more than 70 books. You have 1,000 sermons on cassette. You know, you have all of these articles he's written. Isn't this the kind of Islamic leader you would want in the United States? This is the person who the day after 9/11 ran ads in the New York Times and Washington Post saying no self-respecting, no authentic true Muslim can be a terrorist. Isn't this the kind of person we want in the United States? And the judge says, besides that, he's an ecumenical leader. He's been with the Pope. And the U.S. attorney, the trial's going on in Philadelphia, the U.S. attorney's from Washington, from Homeland Security in Washington. She says, Judge, we think the picture was photoshopped. That they made up the picture. Now, if you've seen any of the pictures of Gulen with the Pope, there are a lot of them. It's not just like one. And they're videos. So, but that is the level of what the government was, our government, United, my government was doing to revoke the religious scholar status. And finally, the judge says, this is a very key point, the judge says, I want whoever's making the decisions in the United States government here in front of me tomorrow morning. Now, when a judge tells you that and you're the lawyer, you know it's not going to be a good morning. He's not going to invite you for coffee. She says, Your Honor, the person making these decisions for the United States is so high up that I cannot bring him to court. So that's either, probably, from what everybody thinks at this point, either Vice President Cheney or Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld. Why would they care? Well, we have the base, the United States has a base in eastern Turkey, right? We have that base that we needed. We wanted to use for our wars and for NATO. Turkey also buys billions of dollars of armaments from the United States. And we also, the United States also brings all of the Turkish new recruits over, not all, but a significant number of the officers to train. So we have a very important monetary relationship. And it wouldn't be hard for somebody to call up Cheney or Rumsfeld and say, hey, you don't really need the preacher, do you? That's the best we can figure. But that's exactly what happened. So anyway, it was the same summer within a month that the judge granted religious scholar status. So three things that month happened. Acquittal, top intellect, religious scholar status is back, right? Now, of course, this is clearly a victory for Gulen, and they asked Gulen what he thought about it. And the only thing he said, well, the judges were courageous. And indeed they were, because they never got promoted. The lower judges never got promoted after that. And in Turkey, the other thing I didn't mention, but I think it was significant in talking about courage, is that when the judges go to their room, retire to deliberate, the prosecutor goes with them. Not the defendant, but the prosecutor. So the judges are always getting the message, what does the state want? And that happens not only at the trial level, but on the appeal level. So when the judges on appeal are deciding the case, you also have the state prosecutor there at the same time. So it was indeed courageous of the judges to do what they did. But it was very important for Turkey. It was very important for Turkey because, as the judges said when they wrote the opinion, this is about democracy. And we can't prosecute people because we don't agree with them. We can't prosecute people because of their beliefs. We can't prosecute people because they're exercising their religious ideas or their religious beliefs. We can't be doing that. It's a pretty remarkable decision to come from the judges in Turkey at that time. It was a very important step, I think, forward for Turkey in terms of the road to democracy. During the book that I wrote, I interviewed a lot of people. I interviewed people that had gone into exile during some of the sometimes during the coups, people who are relatives that had relatives that were killed or tortured. I interviewed a member of parliament who had been shot 22 times in an assassination attempt. You know, people suffered a lot for democracy, and Turkey has made an enormous amount of pressure progress, enormous amount of progress in the last 10, 20 years. Turkey is not perfect, nor is the United States perfect, but it's an amazing road of progress that has gone on. And when I was writing the book, right at the end of it, I came across a quote from Noam Chomsky from MIT. I think he's now retired, but you know, political commentary, commentator. It's an amazing quote. I know of no other country where leading writers, artists, journalists, academics, and other intellectuals have compiled such an impressive record of bravery and integrity in condemning crimes of state and going beyond to engage in civil disobedience, to try to bring oppression and violence to an end, facing and sometimes enduring severe repression, and then returning to the task. It is an honorable record, unique to my knowledge, a record of which Turkey should be proud, and one that should be a model for others. And it was really a great opportunity for me to do the book, and it was a very great opportunity to come and present it to you today, and I thank you for the opportunity.